ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 5, Chapter 1, Text Number 37. Aho asadvanushtitam yad abhiniveshitoham. Indriyair avidya rachita vishama vishayandhakupe. Tat alam alam amushya vanitaya vinoda mrugam. Mam dhig dhig iti garhayam chakara. Aho alas. Asadhu. Not good. Anushthitam, executed. Ya, because abhiniveshitaha, being completely absorbed. Aham, I, indriyaihi, for sense gratification. Avidya, by nations. Rachita, made. Vishama, causing distress. Vishaya, sense gratification. Andhakupe, in the dark well. Ta, that. Alam, insignificant. Alam, of no importance. Amushyaha, of that. Vanitayaha, wife. Vinodamrugam, just like a dancing monkey. Ma, unto me. Dhik, all condemnation. Dhik, all condemnation. Iti, thus. Garhayam, criticism. Chakara, he did. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. The king thus began criticizing himself. Alas, how condemned I have become because of my sense gratification. I have now fallen into material enjoyment, which is exactly like a covered well. I have had enough. I'm not going to enjoy anymore. Just see how I have become like a dancing monkey in the hands of my wife. Because of this, I am condemned. Translation with repetition. The king thus began criticizing himself. Alas, how condemned I have become because of my sense gratification. I have now fallen into material enjoyment, which is exactly like a covered well. I've had enough. I'm not going to enjoy anymore. Just see how I have become like a dancing monkey in the hands of my wife. Because of this, I am condemned. purport by Srila Prabhupada. How condemned is the advancement of material knowledge can be understood from the behavior of Maharaj Priyavrata. He performed such wonderful acts as creating another sun which shined during the night and creating a chariot so great that its wheels formed vast oceans. These activities are so great that modern scientists cannot even imagine how such things can be done. Maharaj Priyavrata acted very wonderfully in the material field of activities. But because he was dealing in sense gratification, ruling his kingdom and dancing to the indications of his beautiful wife, he personally condemned himself. When we think about this example of Maharaj Priyavrata, we can just consider how degraded is the modern civilization of materialistic advancement. Modern so-called scientists and other materialists are very satisfied because they can construct great bridges, roads and machines. But such activities are nothing comparable to those of Maharaj Priyavrata. If Maharaj Priyavrata could condemn himself in spite of his wonderful activities, how condemned we are in our so-called advancement of material civilization. We can conclude that such advancement has nothing to do with the problems of the living entity entangled within this material world. Unfortunately, modern man does not understand his entanglement and how condemned he is, nor does he know what kind of body he is going to have in the next life. From a spiritual point of view, a great kingdom, beautiful wife, and wonderful material activities are all impediments to spiritual advancement. Maharaj Priyavrata had served the great sage Narada sincerely. Therefore, even though he had accepted material opulences, he could not be deviated from his own task. He again became Krishna conscious, as confirmed in the Bhagavad Gita. Niha vikramana shosti pratyavayo na vidyate svalpam apyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhaya. In devotional service, there is no loss or diminution, and even a small service rendered in devotional life is sufficient to save one from the greatest danger. Such renunciation as Maharaj Priyavrata's is possible only by the grace of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Generally, when people are powerful or when they have a beautiful wife, a beautiful home and material popularity, they become more and more entangled. Priyavrata Maharaj, however, having been completely trained by the great sage Narada, revived his Krishna consciousness in spite of all impediments. Thus ends the Bhakti Vedanta Purport. So these are words spoken by Shukadev Goswami about Maharaj Priyavrata. We have been seeing that how Maharaj Priyavrata was a materially very, very successful person, performed wonderful activities, extraordinary activities, had a beautiful wife, had many beautiful, wonderful, very capable children, had palace, had all the opulence of a successful man. Such a king as Priyavrata, a very successful man, how he is reflecting about his own activities. The self-reflection and the self-examination is what is being described in this verse. He begins by saying, Aho Asadhu. So, these are all expressions, Aho Asadhu, Alam Alam, Dik Dik, to show his strong feelings about his own accomplishments in life. Aho Asadhu. When you say in learned circles, Sadhu, Sadhu, that means well spoken, well spoken, good, well done. And so he is saying, Aho Asadhu, I've not done well, not good. Anushtitam yad abhiniveshitaha. I have executed, abhiniveshitaha, I have been absorbed. In what? Aham indriyaihi avidyarachita vishama vishayandakupe abhiniveshitaha. I have been absorbed. In what? In sense gratification, indriyaihi. And in what circumstances? Avidya rachita. Avidya, ignorance, lack of enlightenment, lack of knowledge. And this avidya rachita, this ignorance can create grand things in this world. And I also did such grand things in this world. Avidya rachita, vishama, ultimately it causes distress to the living entity. It doesn't solve the real problems of life. Vishama, avidya rachita, vishama, vishaya, indriya vishaya, vishaya, indriyaihi vishaya. Sense gratification, objects of senses, sense gratification, andakupe. Kupa is a well, but here many times in the Bhagavatam this is described as a andakupa. Andakupa means a dark well. It also means a covered well. It also means a deep well, because it's deep and so it's dark. So andakupe abhiniveshitaha, I've been absorbed. Tad alam alam, enough, enough, if these insignificant things I've been dealing with. Enough, alam alam, insignificant, of no importance. Amushya vanitaya vinodamrugam. I've been all doing all these things. How? On whose inspiration? My beautiful, wonderful wife, vanitaya. And inspired by her, we just read in a few verses before, she was so wonderful, inspiring. That's why they say behind every successful man, there is a wonderful wife. Yes, he had a wonderful wife, she was very inspiring. And now he is realizing, Vanitaya Vinodamurugam. What did I do? I became a dancing monkey. Vinoda, it gives joy. Mruga, and monkey. Sometimes we have in our country a man having a monkey and he'll be doing different things. And then he'll collect, and then we'll all be looking at that. So I have become like a Vinoda, Vanitaya Vinoda Mrugam. And mom, dik dik. These are all very powerful words, very strong words, indicating his feelings. Condemned. Vanitaya, mom, dik dik iti garhayam. Garhayam, criticism, chakara, he did. He criticized himself. So this self-examination, self-reflection is a very special quality of a human being. Animals cannot do self-examination. Animals cannot do self-reflection. Have you ever seen a dog or a cat or a tiger or a bird reflecting, oh, yesterday I did that. Day before yesterday I did that. Last 1 year I have been doing this. Am I doing rightly? They cannot do such reflection, self-reflection. This is one of the distinguishing features of a human being. A human being can reflect. He can self-examine himself. But if such capacity for self-examination, self-reflection, critical thinking, critical self-examination, if these things are not guided, because he has the capacity for self-examination, he has the capacity for reflection, but if that capacity, that aptitude, Prabhupada uses the word, human beings have the aptitude for self-examination. If that aptitude for self-examination is not properly guided with knowledge, with transcendental knowledge, what he will do? Avidya rachita. He will create wonderful things in this material world. So, the king thus began criticizing himself. Garhayam chakara. Alas, how condemned I have become. Alas, aho asadhu. How condemned I have become. Asadhu, how condemned I have become because of my sense gratification. Indriyaihi abhiniveshitaha. I have now fallen into material enjoyment. Indriyaihi vishaya abhiniveshitaha or anushtitam. I have become engaged in sense gratification. I have now fallen into material enjoyment, which is exactly like a covered well. Andhakupam. I have had enough. Alam, alam. I am not going to enjoy anymore. Just see how I have become like a dancing monkey. Vinoda mrugam. In the hands of my wife. Vanitaya vinoda mrugam. Because of this, I am condemned. Dik, dik, maam, dik, dik. Garhayam chakara. In this way, he condemned himself. So, Srila Prabhupada has written very nicely in the purport that compared to what Priyavrata has done, what modern civilization has done, is not all that great. Priyavrata could create the sun, an alternate sun, to shine in the night. He could create oceans. Relatively speaking, even modern civilization has not done things of that scale. Maybe they have built big bridges, big skyscrapers, big cities, big gardens, and all of that, those kind of things. And human beings have become very proud about that. See how well we have done. So, compared to what Priyavrata has done, this is not all that. So when we think about the example of Maharaj Priyavrata, we can just consider how degraded is the modern civilization of materialistic advancement. Modern so-called scientists and other materials are very satisfied because they can construct great bridges, roads and machines. Why do we say that this is not great? You know, see in Western countries, big buildings, big roads, big bridges. Even we are also doing those things in our country now. And why do we say it is not all that? Prabhupada points out. We can conclude how condemned we are. Because they can construct great bridges, roads and machines, but such activities are nothing comparable to those of Maharaj Priyavrata. If Maharaj Priyavrata could condemn himself in spite of his wonderful activities, how condemned we are in our modern so-called advancement of material civilization. We can conclude that such advancement has nothing to do with the problems of the living entity entangled within this material world. Because all those grand activities become feeble to address the real problems of the living entities, which is janma mrutyu jara vyadhi. Finally, when we are dying, if a man is dying, old age, disease, and all that, and he's in the hospital with all the different equipment around him, and there's a nice glass window overlooking, and he's on a skyscraper hospital, and he looks out of the window, there's big bridge there, all that, but he's dying. Big bridge and all the skyscraper. Finally, he's suffering, the body is going through all kinds of pains, and he's remembering all his friends and relatives and family. No one is around him. That is Vishama. That is the distress of the living entity. That's why Bhaktivinoda Thakur composed a very beautiful song. Bhaktivinoda Thakur was highly educated. His family, his time at that time, and his situation was that he was very educated and he was very studious, worked very hard, studying books, and Britishers had introduced English education, and because of English education you could read books from all over the country, all over the world, and he was into all of that. And so he writes, Jada Vidya Jata Mayar Vaibhava. This Vidya, Jada Vidya, this education about the material world, knowledge about the material world, Jada Vidya Jata Mayar Vaibhava. It can create grandiose manifestations. But this is all a grandiose manifestation of the illusory energy of the Lord. So in Western countries, and now even we are doing that in our countries, we have nice cities, trying to get nice cities, but not yet there. Our cities are still very dirty. But maybe sometime we will get there. Nice clean cities, nice gardens, green grass. Seeing all that, this is Mayar Vaibhava. But we don't understand that way. We think this is all wonderful. Jada Vidya Jata Mayar Vaibhava Tomar Bhajana Bhadha. But this Mayar Vaibhava that we may create, it is Tomar Bhajana Bhadha. It becomes an impediment for serving Krishna, for remembering Krishna, for chanting Krishna's holy names and doing devotional service. Because we become attracted to Mayara Vaibhava. Vaibhava means grandiose manifestations. We get captured by that. Jada Vitya Chata Mayara Vaibhava Tumar Bhajana Bhadha. And so how does this all come about? How does this become an impediment? Moha janamiya, because it creates moha, it creates an illusion. That's why when you see those things, big buildings, big nice bridges, roads, cars, machines, gardens, green grass, seeing all that, moha janamiya, it thinks, oh, such a nice place. And we forget, anitya samsare moha janamiya. This samsara refers to material existence. It is anitya. These beautiful gardens and buildings and bridges, it won't be with you forever. Moha janamiya anitya samsare. And to maintain all these things, it's not easy. To maintain big building, parks, gardens, bridges, and good family, and go with them and enjoy, spend money, all these things, you have to work very hard. Jeeva ke karaye gadha. Gadha means a donkey, an ass. In order to enjoy mayar vaibhava, you need money. And to get money, you have to work very hard like a donkey. And so the eternal living entity is turned into a donkey for temporary pleasure. See how the working of Maya is so nicely captured by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Same spirit here, same message here. Avidya rachita vishaya vishama vishayandha kupe. Avidya rachita vishama. So this, with this knowledge of the material world and systematically thinking, because a systematic thinking ability exists in a human being, that systematic thinking has to be guided. If it is not guided, we will be misled. We will get into material, creating mayar vaibhava, and forget that it is anitya samsara. It's a temporary existence. Just like we take a journey in a train. It may be 8 hours train, 12 hours train, maybe 24 hours train. And you have, say for instance, you are having some money in your pocket, all your savings. Now, you don't think, how I'll use this money to beautify this compartment. Now let me spend 1 lakh rupees, beautify this. This color is not good, this is not good, that is, let me be, we don't do that. Because 8 hours, 10 hours, I'll abandon this and go away. But we don't realize that about the material world. Our hard work, our energy, our intelligence, everything, we want to make this one a very beautiful world so that I can live. We forget that it is anitya samsare. So that's the nature of this material existence. Grand material creations of this world. And it is very feeble in solving the real problems of the living entity. It does not have the potency, the grand bridge and the grand houses and the grand buildings and the grand parks we develop does not have the ability to address the real problems that I'll be having. Old age, disease, family problems, all these things it cannot solve. It's too feeble. It is powerless. So this is the avidya rachita, and it leads to vishama, distress for the living entity. And so so this self-examination, self-critical thinking, these are all human abilities, but should be guided with standard knowledge. Nowadays there are a lot of people in our country, they are feeling Bharat, our country. There is so much. So I come across a lot of people like that when we talk, we get to talk to them. And then when I see they're talking, when they're very spirited, very nice people. They really feel for our country. But the real wealth of our country, the real knowledge, real understanding, they have missed out. And they have become little old, you know, they are in their 40s, sometimes 50s. And it's little difficult to give them the proper understanding. Because proper understanding you can get from parampara. One of the characteristics that Prabhupada describes, standard knowledge of God, standard understanding of God, of the material world, of the material situation. What is a standard understanding? Just like in science, there is a standard understanding. What is water made of? Very clear. Standard understanding. It's made of hydrogen and oxygen in these proportions. Because that's a standard understanding. Just like there is a standard understanding about water, and a teacher is supposed to, a science teacher is supposed to teach standard knowledge. Suppose I'm a science teacher and I go to your high school and tell, my dear students, your textbook is wrong. I figured out water is actually made of hydrogen and nitrogen. Please write down. If I do that, and when the school inspector comes, inspects the teacher what he has taught, I'll be fired. Because I didn't teach standard knowledge. Just like there is a standard understanding about God, about water, about the material world, about all these things, there is a standard knowledge and understanding about God, about the absolute truth. What is the absolute truth? And Bhagavad Gita teaches, Bhagavatam teaches, our acharyas teach, and that absolute truth is a person. Krishna. Once when Prabhupada was in Kumbh Mela, few high court judges of Allahabad, because the Kumbh Mela was happening in Prayag, Allahabad, they came and met, and they had read some of Prabhupada's books, and they praised Prabhupada, saying that, Swamiji, you are the only one who is saying that absolute truth is a person. Nobody is saying that. Because that is Krishna's Bhagavad Gita. Aham sarvasya prabhavo matta sarvam pravartate iti matva bhajante mam buddha bhava samanvitaha. Buddha, these are all related words. Buddhi, buddha, buddha. Buddha means an enlightened person. So Krishna is saying Buddha Bhava Samanvitaha. One who is enlightened. Enlightened what? Aham sarvasya prabhavo matha sarvam pravartate. Everything is coming from me. I am the source of everything. Everything is an emanation from me. That ultimate source, ultimate cause, the search of that is Vedanta knowledge. And that Vedanta knowledge, searching for that ultimate cause, ultimate source, ends in understanding Krishna because he is the source of everything. Krishna is standing there in front of Arjuna and he is saying, I am the source. Reading Bhagavad Gita, people misunderstand and think that there is one energy which is the source of everything. Just see how misreading happens. So, standard knowledge we can get from the parampara. And what is that correct parampara? That was one of the important contributions of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. He wrote down, this is parampara and I am coming in this parampara. This is how all the other acharyas have come. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came like this. Krishna came, Brahma came. Now this is Vyasa came. This is the parampara. Because he delineated that parampara, it became a big controversy during his time. Many, many controversies Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur encountered in his life. He courted with many controversies of his time. One of them is this. And he wrote down the parampara. He wrote a Sanskrit composition of that one. And he made a Bengali song around that one. So that it is very firmly established. This is the way the knowledge is coming. Correct knowledge. Standard correct understanding of the Vedic literature is coming in this way. Evam parampara prapta. That's why our acharyas take these words of Krishna as very parampara praptam. You have to receive the knowledge in the parampara. It is received. It's not created. It's not fabricated. It is received. So that is the way this knowledge has to be received. Because you see, in the 13th chapter which we are reading, so nice. Arjuna asks questions. Jnanam, Jnayam, I want to know what is knowledge and what is to be known. And Krishna says, yes, yes, I'll tell you what is to be known. Knowing which Amrutam Ashnute. Knowing this, there is knowledge and there is an object of knowledge to be known by the knowledge, by the process of knowledge. And then Krishna says, this knowledge, this object of knowledge, sukshmatva tad avigneyam, that object of knowledge is unknowable. Look at this, it looks like a contradiction. Now I will tell you what is the object of knowledge, what is to be known. But that to be known is unknowable. You cannot know that. I'll teach you what is to be known, but that is unknowable. What does that mean? Jnayam avigneyaha. It is to be known. It is the object of knowledge, but it is avigneyaha. It cannot be known. It cannot be known by our own effort. It can be known when it descends. And when it descends, it can be known provided we have cultured our consciousness rightly. Just like a farmer, he has to till the ground and make it ready and see that the soil is fertile. And then he has made arrangements for watering and all that. And then seed has to come. And then you will have the plant. If you receive the seed on the rock, it will not grow. If you till the ground and make it fertile and don't get the seed, nothing will come. Both are essential. This knowledge is received in the parampara, and for us to properly comprehend it and appreciate it and realize it, we have to culture our consciousness with sadhana, with regulative principles, controlling the senses, controlling the mind. If these things are not there, even if you have received the wonderful bija, but our heart is rock all solid, it will fall there. A seed can sit on a rock for 1,000,000 years, nothing will happen. See, That is why regulative principles, these are essential to maintain the right consciousness so that the knowledge that Srila Prabhupada is giving is fructified. We realize that knowledge. So, and then he's saying, Andhakupe. And Prabhupada explains this Andhakupa, householder life. Prahlad Maharaj uses the same expression. Tat sadhu manye asuravarya dehinam sadha samudvigna dhyam asat graha hitvatma patam gruhamandakupam vanam gato yad harimashrayeta. Please take shelter of Hari. Hariya harim ashrayeta. He was telling his father. Asadhu manye, tat sadhu manye. Here he is saying asa, aho asadhu. Prahlad is using the word tat sadhu manye. Because his father asked him, what is the good thing you have learnt, my dear son, from the teachers in the school? And so he was thinking that he is going to tell him avidya, rachita, vishama, all those grand things we have to create in the material world, like my father has created. But the son said, tat sadhu manye asuravarya dehinam sada samudvigna dhyam asat grihat. This dehinam asat grihat, the living entity who has accepted this body, asat grihat has now become engaged in the material world. So his consciousness dhyam will be sada samudvigna dhyam. Will always be filled with anxiety. So, Prahlad Maharaj's recommendation was also, hitvatma patam gruhamandakupam. Atma patam means that place which will kill self-realization. That situation which can kill self-realization is called atma patam. So, householder life is considered to be an atma patam. Gruham andakupam. It's like a dark well. Why is it a dark well? Srila Prabhupada analyzes why it's a dark well in different places and gives at least four reasons. One, dark well, covered well. In this translation, Prabhupada has translated andakupa as a covered well. So, you are walking and it is nice, green is there. You are thinking, so wonderful. I can walk over that, and you walk. It was actually a thin layer of grass. Underneath that was a deep well, and you fell into it. So that's one of the things happens. We see in the material, look, oh, how men and women so nicely they're enjoying. So nice child there, brah, see? They're walking around so much nicely. Car, they came out of the car. Child also jumped out of the car. Look at the woman, so nicely she is dressed. So we see all these things. So nice. Can I also look for that situation? And bang, we fall into the well. So it's called a covered well. The living entity sometimes falls into. So that's one expression, one understanding of andhakupam. And the second one is, Prabhupada explains, it's a well. Why does one go to a well for water? But inside the well, sometimes the well becomes dry. And this was one such well. One fellow went into the water, picked up water, and then he found, after entering the well deep there, there's no water. There's no pleasure. We look for pleasure and go enter a householder life. But there is no pleasure there. You were looking in the wrong direction. That's the second reason. You fall into the well and looking for water. But it's a deep, dark, andhakupam means if there is no water there, it was abandoned well. But you fell into it because you're such an intelligent man. And there's no water there. And there's no water there. There's no pleasure there. So that's second reason. Third reason, Prabhupada explains. what is the third reason? Okay. Invariably it happens in our temple. We have seen, I've come across many devotees.
Devotee Brahmachari becomes a Grihastha. And then it goes on for some time. After maybe 3 months, maybe. Sometimes 6 months. Maybe sometimes the illusion is a little longer. 1 year. And then the Prabhu comes, the devotee comes and says, Prabhu, my wife is like that. Prabhu, this way, Prabhu, this is not getting along. Prabhu, it's full of problems, Prabhu. Prabhu, I think now I'm feeling that I made a mistake. Can I undo it? Usually what I preach is, many times I have done, no, don't worry, it's you to tolerate, it'll all become all right, you know, chant Hare Krishna, go continue, go back to your house. Nobody will come and help him. That's the nature of a deep, dark well. You go there and you keep crying, shouting. People may look at you and they say, they'll be there. Nobody can help because you have got into your marriage. It's a serious thing. Don't think it's a light thing. Another person's life is involved. You made a promise in front of the fire, in front of all your father-in-law, mother-in-law, your father, mother, you made a priest, so many of them. You have to keep stay there only. You have to tolerate it. You can't just think, now I'll come out. No, you cannot. It's deep. You've fallen there. You remain there. And the fourth reason Prabhupada gives is, and when you have fallen into the well, you cannot come out by your own effort. You need the help of a rope. And that rope, and you need somebody who has to come and give, if it's just a rope lying like that, and you start climbing that, it'll come back, right? It won't hold. You need a strong man who is holding on to their strong rope, and he says, just hold on to that rope, I'll pull you up. So you need a spiritual master who throws the rope below. And that rope is instructions, Guru's instructions. So you need a strong man, spiritual master. You need a strong man giving strong instructions, this rope. And then we have to hold on to the instructions of the spiritual master. Then the spiritual master will pull us out of the rope, out of the well. That's why these expressions are used in the Vedic literature. And very strongly he's reflecting on these things. Dig, dig iti garhayam chakara. How condemned I have become involved in sense gratification. This is how every spiritualist must self-examine, self-reflect. How is it that I'm still involved in sense gratification? How is it that I'm still running after sense gratification? Dig, dig, I am condemned verily. Garhayam chakara. So, Shukadev Goswami describing Parikshit, Priyavrata Maharaj's situation with these beautiful words. We'll stop here. Grantharat Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki.